Welcome to the Black Delegates podcast. Today is March 26, 2018. I got with me in the fake studios of the Black Delegates, Ghetto Phenom.
What's good?
And Paul.
What's up, fellas?
And me, I'm the Black Ryan. This week in Blackness, let's start with you, Ghetto Phenom.
All right, so for this week in Blackness, I have a question for both of you gentlemen. It's a little bit of a, like a rhetorical type of question or a little riddle. Okay. So if a white person says the N-word and there is no black person around, should he still get punched in the mouth?
If now, a tree falls in the woods and it makes no sound, it doesn't make a sound. Can
we have, I feel like for the benefit of that, we need some context. We need some context around this.
Right, right. I'm going to give you context. And actually, I should have said if a black person didn't hear it instead of if a black person's not around. Oh. So on Friday night, I went to my homie's house. This is a Caucasian individual. Play some cards, play a little bit of poker. And this is a good friend of mine. This guy's been in my wedding.
Is this the friend that I know?
Yeah, you know.
Okay.
And, you know, been playing cards with him and, you know, doing different projects and been good friends for probably about the last 15 years or whatever. So I was over his house Friday night. And usually at the poker game, I'm usually the only black person. Well, I'm not the only. It's another black guy that usually comes. So it's usually either one of us or it's both of us. So there's usually one or two black people there. The rest of the people are white. But again, I've known these people for a long time. Everybody cool or whatever. No beef. So this past Friday, I was over there, you know, playing cards or whatever. And there's this new guy who it was his first time coming. Somebody, you know, another regular had invited him or whatever. And the guy was a little peculiar. I would look up a couple of times to see, you know, if it's his turn to act, his turn to bet or play or whatever. And he would be, like, looking at me, like, just kind of weird. Like, his eyes would be open. And I was just like, what's this dude? And I know he was drinking or whatever. So I'm like, maybe this dude, I don't know, just kind of an odd fellow.
Okay.
So anyway, so at one point, I heard him say something. I think it was something about Post Malone. But I'm looking at my cards. It's my time to bet. So I'm not really paying attention to what he's saying. I heard Post Malone. And then all of a sudden, I looked up at him to see if he's going to play. And he's looking back at me weird or whatever. And he's like, excuse me, you know, I've been drinking. And, you know, I think I said something inappropriate. You know, I noticed you looking at me. And he's talking to me. And I was like, no, I'm looking at you to see if it's your turn to play. And he turns to my friend's wife and is like, yeah, I see you looking at me too, you know. And so she's like, no, I wasn't, you know, I didn't hear you. So we both like, well, what did you say? And he's like, oh, nothing. Don't worry about it.
Oh, dang.
And so
I can hear the music stopping, the little record scratch going.
Right. And I mean, like,
was everybody at the table looking at you?
Everybody's still kind of playing or whatever. And so, so me and my friend's wife were both like, no, what'd you say? Like, you just making a big deal? Like, what'd you say? He's like, oh, nothing. I thought you guys, you know, never mind. Don't worry about it. So I'm just like, okay, you know, whatever. So I didn't even really trip off of it because, like I said, the dude was just kind of peculiar anyway. So a few minutes later, my friend who was hosting the party, his brother comes over. His wife is sitting next to me on the other side, the brother's wife. And so he comes over and whispers something in her ear. So then she starts to text the other friend's wife, whose house we're at. She texts her and shows me the text on the phone. And the text said, I think he said the N-word.
Uh-oh.
And so I look at the text and I'm like, Like, I don't really know how to react right now. Because number one, I didn't hear him say it. And it said, I think he said the N-word. And nobody else in the at the party really said anything. Like, everybody was kind of like the same way that me and his wife were, like, well, what did you say or whatever. So it was just a weird situation because I'm like, okay, did this dude say the N-word? Do I go and smack him in the mouth? Do I give him a pass? Because I didn't hear, and I really didn't know what to do. So to make a long story short, Well, I guess not short, it's already long, but I really didn't even react because I'm like, I don't know if he said it for sure, and I didn't hear him say it. So I just kind of was like, I gotta just pay attention to this dude now and see, you know, what else he says after that. So after this dude ended up getting knocked out and he left, you know, pretty much right away, then the conversation opened up at the table and people were like, oh my gosh, I can't believe he said that. And I'm like, oh, so y'all heard it? Like, I thought that his brother was the only one who thought that he heard it. And then apparently people were like texting back and forth, you know, like, hey, did he say what I think he said? Did he just say blah, blah, blah? So maybe nobody had heard it for sure, but it was just an interesting dynamic. And like I said,
I didn't hear him saying it for sure. They did. They definitely heard it for sure. Multiple people heard it.
That's what I still don't even know. I think the brother definitely heard it, but I think a lot of other people, I think they heard it, but they weren't sure they heard him correctly.
But in what kind, was he like, was a song playing? And he was just reciting lyrics, or what was he doing?
And that's the thing too. I didn't have any context about it. So after when we're talking about
Post Malone is a white dude, I think.
Yeah, he is.
Okay.
And this is what the guy supposedly said. So they were talking about music or something like that, and somebody—I don't know if somebody brought up Post Malone, but he's—I think he said, "Yeah, if Post Malone, you know, is out here acting niggerly," and it's like niggerly.
What? And so, dog. Hey man, you know my dad told me one time. He said sometimes gotta close your ears so you don't hear some things, so you won't react a certain way, man. And I think that's what happened, because that would have been deserving of a of a punch to the jaw, man. So I guess from your point of view, yes, the answer would be, you know, it was grounds for stealing on a dude, but at the same time, you ain't hear it, so you ain't have to deal with the repercussions of that.
Yeah, I didn't get the facts until after he was gone. But I'm like, first of all, niggerly is just a weird word. But
hey, man, yeah, it's got like, nigga in it.
Oh, and I told my partner, I'm like, yo, I'm like, y'all lucky I didn't hear that. Because I said, if I would have heard that, I wouldn't have went over and punched him in his mouth. And what he was like, you would have been in when you're right. He was like, I wouldn't have been mad at you. He was like, that's what he deserved. He was like, you know, so if that ever happens, he was like, you got my permission to, you know, punch somebody in the mouth. And, you know, he basically apologized on behalf of white people and said, you know, this guy's not going to be invited back. And, you know, like I said, everybody was appalled.
Yeah, that was my next question. What was everybody else's reaction? How they were like, this is going to slide, or this dude's
yeah,
like,
no, cool, after he left. Well, I will say my partner's wife, like right away, you know, she was like pissed. Like whenever she got the text, you know, she was like visibly pissed. She was more mad about it than me, because I was just like, did he really? Like,
so was the other black dude there at that time? No?
No, the other black dude wasn't there.
Okay.
This Friday. So I was the only black dude there.
He's just looking to bank somebody.
But I was just like, it was just weird, because as soon as he left, you know, then like it kind of opened up for conversation. So I guess maybe they were just too afraid to say something, you know, thinking that I would go off and hit him or whatever. But it was like, while he was there, nobody said anything, but people were texting. And again, this is something I found out after the fact. They were texting each other about it, like, hey, did he just say that? Oh my gosh, I can't believe. And meanwhile, I was down there the whole time, and I saw that text that said, I think he said the N-word, but I was just like, I didn't hear it. I don't know the context. I don't know. And I had even asked a guy, like, what did you say? He's like, oh, nothing. So I was just like, well, I'm gonna just keep playing cards, which was good because I ended up winning. But it was still just kind of weird, because I'm just like, man, like. Dang. So that's my week in blackness.
Yep, that's pretty black. friend's brother.
He was a friend of somebody who was a regular. He wasn't the guy who lived there. Didn't know him. He had never met him. But which is my partner, but he was, yeah, yeah. That'd probably
be the question.
Is, but yeah, he told me the guy,
because they should have, for real, you know, if you're keeping it 100 and you not down with that, you should have immediately been kicked out from the table,
right?
Whether you heard it or not, you know what I'm saying? And that should have been the thing that you noticed happening, was a scuffle of them saying, "Man, get out of my house,"
right?
You know
exactly. Exactly. But then again, you know, and this is something I was thinking about over the weekend after it happened. I was like, well, in black families, I mean, do we do that? Like, if we have, or not even black families, but just if we had a card party, if we had a spades party, and there was a white person there, and somebody said something, you know, racist against white folks, used a racist term or a derogatory term, but we kick them out. Or if somebody used a derogatory term for gay people and there was a gay person there, well, we kick them out. We might say, hey, man, that's not cool. Chill out with that. But will we kick them out?
I've had a situation similar to this. We don't have to get into it now because this going
no,
on.
No, man, go ahead. It's fine. We in it. About,
okay.
We in it.
I mean, I got a situation that's, I mean, not exact. Not, I think yours is worse-ish by far. So I won't, but I'll just keep it short. So, like, my wife, she had, like, a friend. And so, like, we got invited over to a Christmas party or like, Christmas party, New Year's Eve party. I can't remember. I think it was, like, a Christmas party. But it was at somebody's house. And so it was just a few of this girl's friends, her husband, some other friends, you know, that kind of, I knew a little bit, not really. But anyway, like, so then the girl's mom and her boyfriend, so this is the girl who invited us over, her mom, so it was like, you know, she's like older than us, you know, maybe 50s at that time, right? And her boyfriend, who's this older dude, black dude, he's probably a little bit older than her. She's like 40, 50. But hey, believe me, the mom was fine. So okay. So we're just hanging out there, but of course it's me there, right? So I'm just chilling, you know, and so I'm just like, you know, hey, it's a small, you know, it's a small house, and we're over there, you know. So I don't know anybody, but I'm trying to be, you know, cool. And the chick's husband, you know, he's like my age, and so we're just talking and we're cool. And so we're like, we're playing, you know, we got there a little early, so we're playing video games, whatever like that, you know. He's keeping me keep me company, entertained. We're, you know, just, it's just cool. But when the mom and the boyfriend come out, the whole vibe just changed. And he was clearly drunk, right? And so he probably was planning on what he was going to, you know, get into with the mom later on. Because like I said, she was fine, dog. So she was, but he was talking smart to me the whole time. So, he kind of kept saying these little things like, you know, like little, you know, like I don't know what he was saying, like Pepe Le Pew or you know, Speedy Gonzalez, or, you know, like something, you know, just little slick things like that. And the first two times, like first couple times, and he was a big dude. He was, you know, older and bigger than me for sure. So I'm, you know, it probably wasn't like an ish situation where he was probably like, man, I'm gonna kill this dude.
Absolutely.
So I'm like, you know, I'm sitting there like, man, I'm in this other people's house. I don't know anybody. A few of these people are family members.
You're the only non-black person there.
Only
right?
Non-black person there. Which, yeah. You know, but Ryan, you know, I'm used to that. So that doesn't faze me too much. But you know, it was just a weird space. Like I'm in this other person's house. I don't know any of these people really. But you know, I know a few of them. They seem cool. But you know, they're family. And this chick's mom's boyfriend is just kind of digging at me. And I was like, you know, the first couple times I just didn't say nothing. I just kind of went over to the kitchen, you know, my wife was over there, you know, in with them. And my wife kind of said, like, I think he's, you know, drinking like that. So I was kind of like, yeah, just kind of watch out. And so we just, you know, I just let it slide. Because what am I going to do, you know? I mean, it wasn't anything to the level Ish is talking about. But then, like, I don't know. I can't remember exactly what the dude said. But he said something just clearly even more offensive. And I think, and I want to say, in the meantime, the husband, the owner of the house, you know, the husband of the girl that invited us over, she had pulled him aside and said, hey, you know, you need to chill out, man. Yeah, he's invited over here. You know, unbeknownst to me. And so he had told dude, like, just chill out. You know, you've been hitting the sauce a little too hard. I know you're trying to have a good time. Or whatever. So, but anyway, you know, fast forward 10, 15 minutes later, man, he said something else again, man. And I was like, man, do I, you know, I was in a weird space just like you wish. Probably I was like, man, do I try to kill this?
Throw them hands. Throw them hands.
Hey, but the dude had me by a good 70 pounds. You know, he's a much older dude. The chick's mom is, you know, mom. You know, it could have been really messy. It could have been really, really messy. So I'm like, what about, you know, just put, it's in a weird space. And you're just like, man, you didn't figure. You think you're just going over to a Christmas party, you know, wearing a nerdy sweater and just be like, hey, I'm going to chill out, drink a little eggnog, right, and go home.
Right.
And you're like, man, I might have to throw these hands. So it's like, but you know, that's, I'm fortunately, I'm older now, so that, you know, that. But it was a weird headspace. But anyway, the husband, you know, he heard it because he was right, you know, because he said it real smart. And the whole room just got quiet, like looked at him like, man, what is wrong with you, dude? You know, because he way older than us. He's just acting crazy in there. I mean, clearly drinking, you know, and thinking he about to, you know, freak off with the mom or whatever like that.
So did they kick him out?
Yeah. So basically dude kicked him out. Dude's like, man, you got to go. So man, dude supported me. And I appreciate that, man. But yeah, it definitely made it weird, man. We never went back over there again. to the house. But, you know, I thought they were going to be, you know, I thought like, oh man, this would be, you know, the dude's real cool. You know, they got kids, you know, we don't have kids at the time, but, you know, real cool. You know, I could see them, you know, just kind of, you know, doing a couple type things, whatever like that. But like after that, I was like, you know, even the dude apologized to me and all that stuff, but I was just like, yeah, just, it was just weird. My wife left without taste, my wife's mouth, all that stuff like that. So anyway, it was, yeah, I had a situation kind of like that. Not as messed up as that, but yeah, it put you in a weird headspace because you're like, man, what do I, you know, yeah, do I just stop this dude out in front of all these dudes?
I would say.
Yeah, and I think yours is even,
yeah, it's blatant,
even worse, you know, because he was coming to you directly. You know, mine was kind of,
oh yeah, he, no, yeah,
something
he,
wait, said wait. In the air, and I didn't hear it. But I think, I mean, if a guy was coming at me directly like that, I would at least made an issue of it. You know,
yeah,
what I'm saying?
I
would have addressed it head on, because it's like, you don't necessarily got to go punch him in the mouth, although
yeah,
I might have been privy to that. But I would have been like, yo, look, like, either I'm about to go, you about to go, like, some, you're not about to keep talking to me that way, you know?
Man, yeah, I mean, it's like, you know, in an interracial relationship with my wife, at least, you know, it's like, you guys both met her, so she, you know, she's a pretty girl. I'm not saying she's, you know, she ain't no supermodel or anything like that, but she's a pretty girl. So, you know, you know, sometimes when you go around other, you know, no offense, black dudes, that, you know, it's either really two ways to do it. Like, it's some dudes kind of, you can tell they're kind of salty about it, like, hey, why is she with this dude or whatever like that. And then some dudes just kind of like, you know, they give you your props. Maybe they still up salty about it, but they try to give you your props.
But
like,
them Deezus and Mero dudes, they be like, yeah, she just in it for the money. That's what they be saying.
Hey, but then Ryan, you know how broke I was in college, and she was with me during college, so you know that's not true.
You just pull out a stack and wave it on your face, man, and be like, yeah, I'm rich.
Dog, hey, senior year of college, I was no richer than we were freshman year of college, Ryan, so you know that ain't true. So, but you know, so it's a weird space. So, you know, I'm kind of used to, you know, interacting with folks, and like, you know, some dudes a little salty. I know, especially older black dudes, like I definitely feel the salt, the hate emanating from them occasionally. But you know, usually no big deal. But I've never had a dude like just directly talk to me like that. But again, he was on the sauce, so you know, I kind of gave him a little bit of benefit of doubt. But anyway, I don't. Long story short, yeah, I've had a situation like that before. It definitely is weird, uncomfortable.
Yeah, we are definitely. We are definitely a messy people when it comes to interracial relationships. You know what I'm saying? We definitely have people who scowl and frown and give you side eyes and act, you know, all different kind of ways. So,
I have rarely heard black people say something like blatantly racist, like call a racist term or a name or something. I mean, I've had where they treat you funny until you, you know, almost get into a fight, and then they be like, oh, they cool. Like that kind of situation. And it's always people that are being like, man, you need to chill or you need to leave kind of stuff. I mean, I've had that happen.
Man, so, well, hey, like I said, yeah. I went to super ghetto high schools in various places. So I've seen it all.
And but, disclaimer, Paul, because I don't want you to get up off the show. I'm not saying your wife is with you for any kind of money. No, did not have any money.
I apologize.
No, I'm about to walk over here, and me and my wife about to have a podcast. We're going to talk about this for 3 days.
Great. What about you, Ryan? You got anything for this week in blackness?
I probably can. I'll keep it short, though, but my week in blackness was pretty black as of Sunday. Had to do a little preaching, and then the blackest thing, you know, that I know of is a black church anniversary.
Yeah,
you don't want to go to a black church anniversary because you know they gonna hold too long.
Done and done, players. Done.
So
and done.
I left immediately from my church. So I'm leaving there. We left early, man. Well, early by our standards. So we left at like 1:30, something like that. We're gonna roll over there real quick. You know, they got food and this and that. I'm thinking when we get there, like, food is gonna be being served, and then we'll get into whatever we're gonna do after that. Oh no. You know, black people, we come in and it's a program. And I'm like, oh, okay, maybe just a couple people going to sing a couple songs. Everybody had an A and B selection. Everybody, about 3-4 people. We had a group from our church have an A and B selection. Somebody from their church had an A and B selection. Some old people from their church had an A and B selection. Then somebody danced. Man, it just wouldn't stop. Then a couple other people got up and talked. And I mean talked for 20 minutes. Then they had the nerve to say, could all the ministers stand to have a word, if you would? And I was like, don't ever tell a minister to stand up and have a word, because most of these mugs don't know when to stop talking.
Right.
So it was cool. The first person, you know, got up, said something quick, and then it went to this other brother. I ain't know him at all. I'd never seen him before. And he went on a 30-minute sermon. Mm-hmm. We looking at this brother like, what is he doing? We hungry. We just came from our church. We already then went through all these songs, man. People was talking. People was praying for too long. What are you doing?
Hey, for real.
It's just too much.
I know I'm gonna get spitting down. I know I'm going straight to hell anyway. But man, hey, I would have just left a Chick-fil-A run and came back in there with a Chick-fil-A bag. And be like, hey man, you guys don't Chick-fil-A
in the hood. Ain't no Chick-fil-A in the hood. I ain't had that kind of
Arby's, Popeyes, whatever you got. I'm going to get something. And like, I gotta take a break, and I gotta come. I'll come back, but I ain't gonna be here for this whole thing. I'm sorry.
Yo, Ish, we was off clearance. We was off clearance. Ain't nothing but McDonald's and White Castle right there.
Hey, stop by, just smuggle that double quarter pounder in your wife's purse, bro.
Yeah, but eventually got it over.
Need to bring that wrap it up bell in there. That's what you need to do. Like play them
off. The worst part when they do, like everybody comes sing a selection. You know, they got the guest churches and they have people come and do their songs. Like you said, the A and the B song. And the worst part is, a lot of these visiting churches, the people that come to the anniversaries are older people. Yes. And so you got this choir from Mount St. Bethlehem of Jediah, whatever. And all the choir and all the people that are there are like 80 years old, and they sitting in the back. So then they like, hey, you know, why don't y'all come up and sing your song? And so it take 5 minutes for them just to get to the front of the church to sing their song. And then they sing their song, and you're like, all right, yeah, here's the applause. And then they go to the B song. So I feel your pain, brother. I done been to more of those church anniversaries than I care to.
And probably had the heat going full blast the whole time.
It was hot. It was hot. I had a button down on. I had to roll my sleeves up.
I was getting little fans.
I would not last 15 minutes. Now I've been like, I got to go, man. I got to go. Sorry.
Yeah. They give those mortuary fans. Have you noticed that the church fans always advertise by mortuary?
Of course.
Oh, yeah. Oh, hey, my wife's family makes those, man. Watch it.
Exactly.
Actually, we got Brown and Crouppen joints. So they up in there talking about work comp.
Nice.
That's what ours say. Yeah.
Hey, Ryan, if you ever invite me to one of your sermons, hey, 20 minutes, that's it. That's all I can give you, man.
Bro,
that's it.
I'm gonna talk for more than 20 minutes, I promise. If I'm the main event, man. You can't be over in 20 minutes.
Well, hey, don't be
can
mad
you give
when
me
I
30?
Up,
can you
don't
give
be
me
mad
30?
When I come up. I for you 30, but I'm gonna bring my rallies bag in there. Don't be pissed. Okay? I'm bringing my rallies bag, and I might have a Game Boy up in there or a Nintendo DS or something. Don't be mad, man.
Who got a pizza box in the back pew? It's Paul.
Hey, don't worry, Ish. I got you, man. I'm gonna share. You got two slices, no problem, man.
That's what's up. Hey, I'm with it then.
All right, so let's get into this news, man. So
we are not on a good start.
I'll be straight, man. I probably get shaved down a little bit.
This is like a black church episode right here. We going long. Get your snacks right
intro.
Now.
Right. So, Black Panther, the almighty Black Panther, reached $1 billion worldwide and broke the record of the Avengers for the highest grossing superhero film to date. So, I want to give a round of applause for the Black Panther.
Yes. Smart. Golf clap.
Nice. Why are you clapping so late?
That's the wrong clap. Thought it was some hoes in this house. My bad. My bad. Wrong kind of party. Wrong podcast.
So I don't think anybody has any kind of disagreement or beef with Black Panther. Although I know I've heard some other folks talking about it's not really worthy of such numbers. Hold on.
But this is a really long question I got, Ryan. So, okay, as people may or may not know, Ryan is a huge Star Wars fan, or has been in the past.
No, I'm not. Stop it. Don't lie.
You like these movies. Come on now.
I watch them. Okay. I'm not a huge Star Wars fan, though, but go ahead.
Okay, so Star Wars The Force Awakens is the top grossing movie of all time. So Black Panther is at domestically 600 and something, 650 million $1,000 mm-hmm. and Star Wars Force Awakens at $936.
Okay.
Do you think it's better than that movie?
Was Black Panther better than Force Awakens? Well, I'm going to by default say yes, because Force Awakens was completely stolen and plagiarized from A New Hope.
Okay.
So yes.
Okay.
Yep. So I would like nothing better than for Black Panther to be able to bring it down, but it's not going to happen because this Avengers movie is probably going to top Black Panther too.
Well, if they get it for 3 months, that's still something, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. We'll take what we can get. You know, we're climbing the charts regardless, but I don't think it's going to I don't think it'll get up that high because it's only got a few more. Because what? Avengers comes out at the end of April, so that'll be it for that. Nobody seeing Black Panther after Avengers comes out.
But you got the international audience.
I don't know. I don't know if the Avengers is going to pass, at least maybe not domestically.
Infinity War? Come on, man. Yes, it will.
I don't know, because the thing is with Black Panther, so many people were going to see it 2-3 times, and like every black person in the world went and saw Black Panther. So it's like,
but Black Panther in that joint too.
Yeah, you're going to get some of that crossover appeal. Like, that's the good thing, is a lot of black people are now invested in the series, so they will go, but not everybody. They're not going to bus kids to go see the Avengers. You know how many schools we saw busing full kids to the theater? So I don't know if it's going to surpass it. I think it'll do big numbers, but I think Black Panther was just a phenomenon that we haven't really seen, and I don't know if that buzz is quite as strong as the Avengers. I think globally, you know, there is a bigger market, so it might do well, but I don't know if it'll be Black Panther. I don't know. We'll see.
I don't know, because I think more white people might come out to see Avengers than did Black Panther. So, yeah. Well, we'll see. We'll see how that goes.
It's good to be in the mix, though, right? It's good to
be in
the mix.
Definitely, definitely. I ain't complaining about
shout
that.
Shout out to the Black Panther fan.
Yeah.
I mean, you pretty much guaranteed, I mean, this guarantees there are going to be at least three or four spinoffs. This ain't going to be a one spinoff and done. This is going to be a 3, 4, 5 arc at least, and probably a reboot at some point during. I mean, look at all these movies. You got Avengers, Star Wars, Avatar. Well, Titanic don't count. And then Jurassic. All those are multi-film reboots and things like that, except for Titanic. So there. I mean, yeah, this is going to be a 4 or 5 movie deal, no matter what. So this is people eating good, making good money. For years to come. So,
yeah. And let me tell you the power of the vibranium too. I forgot about this until just now, but I told you about, you know, my whole little poker situation on Friday.
Well, power I of ended the vibranium.
Up,
okay.
Yeah, I ended up winning that poker game that day, and it was the first day I bought like a little keychain with a Black Panther mask, and I just took it off the keychain, and I used that as my card protector. So,
nice.
You know, you set it on your card, so nobody knocked your cards away. So that was the first time I used my Black Panther card protector. And even though somebody dropped the niggerly on me, I still won. I still got the victory. So, you know, shout out to Black Panther.
All right.
Hoo-hoo.
Ryan, what we got next, man?
So now we got to leave good black people news to bad black people news. Another unarmed black man gunned down. This time, Stephon Clark was shot and killed in his grandmother's backyard. Shot 20 times by the police in Sacramento, California. Of course, all of us, we just watched the video here a second ago. I think this happened. When did this happen? What
like
day last
Thursday,
week?
Thursday, Friday. Like Thursday, okay. Friday.
Thursday, Friday last week. And so, we've had a little bit of time to, I guess, read the story over, and then we watched the helicopter video today. And I'm gonna start with you, Ishmael. What you think about that situation? Because it's not as clear cut, I guess, as I thought it was gonna be.
And to me, it is pretty clear cut. I mean, certainly when you look at it, and sadly, it is. You know, something that we have become accustomed to. I mean, almost like the school shootings, which just keep on happening over and over. You know, the same thing with unarmed black men just getting gunned down by the cops. And so in this situation, you know, you see the officers yelling, gun, 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 and they shot him over 20 times. So why are you shooting somebody 20 times? And clearly it was dark, it was night, so they didn't see a gun. It's not like he turned and pointed his phone at them. And the fact that, number one, that they shot him like that, and then minutes later, you know, they say, oh, mute the camera, you know, basically is what he meant. And they muted the body cams. I mean, it just shows you once again that there was something nefarious going on. They knew that they messed up. So they muted the cameras, and that shouldn't even be an option.
Should never happen. Yeah.
That shouldn't be an option on these cameras. But the thing is that our lawmakers are so inclined to protect the law enforcement, you know, especially when it comes to incidents with Black Americans or Brown Americans, that, you know, they build all these little, just ways out. So why would a body camera have a mute button? Why is that an option? It just shouldn't be. Everything's supposed to be above board. This is supposed to be about accountability. But the officers go, they mute the camera. They get their story straight that they're going to tell. You know, luckily, the people out there in Sacramento were protesting. People nationally aren't standing for it. And so, you know, there's going to be an investigation. But, we just seen this so many times now that I'm exhausted just seeing this type of thing happen.
Yeah. And so the reason why I said it was not as clear cut, and that's only because so we watched the helicopter footage. So it shows him, I guess, a couple doors down. He was in some cars and things like that, it looked like. And then he took off running, which, I mean, I thought it was kind of strange that Sacramento rolling like that you got the helicopters out looking for people just breaking their cars. Like, that's a lot of money, but that's, you know, that's another topic. They could do what they want to do with their tax money. But, so I do agree that, so regardless of whether or not he's in the wrong in the first place, I wish that we wouldn't be in the wrong to be in these situations. But even when we're in the right, it don't matter, right? We still end up with the same result. The police come around a corner. You can see on the video that, you know, he can't really see around the wall. I mean, he's trying, I guess the camera will be on his chest level, so maybe he could peek his head around a little bit. But it's just that people are real eager to pull out guns and start shooting when you know you're in a Black neighborhood. And we don't get the same benefit of the doubt that you would get in a more prosperous or white neighborhood. We will, it's always an overuse of force, which, you know, there's absolutely no reason to shoot somebody 20 times.
Yeah, when you think about even the Austin situation where you had the bomber out there in Austin, I think when the police cornered him, you know, or whatever, had him in the street, I think there was one bullet that was fired, and then he blew himself up, of course. But So you got a guy who's going around bombing people who you know is armed, whether it's with a weapon, a handgun, or whether it's with a bomb, and they shot one time there. But this guy is in the backyard, you know, with a cell phone, and you shoot him 20 times. And when you look at that footage and just see, I mean, look, it almost looked like one of the officers had a fully automatic rifle. Now, I don't know, he might have just been quick with the trigger finger or whatever, but I mean, his gun was just firing repeatedly, just rapidly and repeatedly. So the fact that you shoot somebody 20 times because you think there might be a gun,
right?
Like, that's just crazy. And that doesn't happen when the suspect is a Caucasian individual. That's just fact.
Yeah. And I mean, we see situations where the Parkland shooter, he comes in, clearly shoots up a whole school, and some kind of way he's brought in with no bruises. He's fine. No big deal. And it happens over and over again, and we just give him the same excuse that, oh, well, they fear for their life. They always fear for their life when it's a Black person standing across from them. What you think, Paul?
All right. This might get me suspended for a couple weeks from the the Black Delegates podcast, but like, I agree with everything you guys are saying. I guess my concern with this particular case, and I like to base these stories. Ryan, you and I have had years of conversation. It feels like
many.
Yes, many. I'm down for all, you know, everything you guys are saying. I believe that there is, you know, definitely profiling. I definitely think that they're scared and all these things like that. I'm not saying there's no but. I'm just saying that, you know, if there's anybody listening to this podcast, man, just don't put yourself in situations where you might get shot by the cop. You know the odds are stacked against you. Don't do things that get you that will increase your odds of getting shot, because they do want to. I'm not saying they do want to shoot, but they do. The odds are higher that they're going to try to shoot black and brown people, and particularly black people in rough neighborhood, in black neighborhoods. So, I mean, is it fair? No, but just be safe and do the right things that, hey, at the end of the day, your family wants you to come home to them. You want to go home to your family. The cop wants to go home to his family. The cop's family wants them to come home to them. So, you know, do the things. If cops are chasing you, if you see a helicopter light on you, and this is a part where I'm kind of lost on this story, just to be honest with you, man. If you see helicopter lights following you around, even if you did nothing at all, and I don't know what he did, you know, if he's breaking their cars or vandalizing or like that, that's all well and good. But man, if you see a helicopter, you know that helicopter is out there looking for somebody. And if that light shined down on you, you know that they're looking for you, man. And you hear the cops coming after you and you run around and getting chased. I mean, that I'm not saying it's right. 20 shots is too much. But that's two cops. They probably got two pistols with 10 bullets in each, and they both unloaded on that dude. But this is what happens when you piss off people, man. They got guns, and it's just bad. It's just a bad combination. I'm not saying, you know, hey, if he doesn't think he did anything wrong, you know, that's what we got the court for. But don't.
But here's another side. Here's a flip side to that. So let's say that you are, whatever. Let's say you are Paul, which you are a Hispanic individual, and you got cops that are coming after you. Now, whether you did something wrong or didn't do anything wrong, when you look at what's going on around this country,
totally with
to
you.
Where
totally with you, on that.
You know that these people are shooting black and brown people, you know, whether totally, they did
I'm
something
totally
or not.
Totally with you on that. But I'm just like,
will you not run and try to get the hell out of there?
No, because at the end of the day, I want to go home to my family. And I know that if I run, that they're going to shoot. It's like what we talked about last week when you were driving the stick shift for the first time and the cops pulled up behind you. Hey man, you sit up straight. You put you turn the music down. You put the bass at a reasonable volume, and you got the hands at 10 and 2. And that's don't give them no reason to pull you over. You drive.
It don't matter though, Paul. Yeah, because if you can do that, you'll get shot anyway. If you take exactly. if you reach to get your license, you'll get shot anyway.
You yep. can.
If you just at the store, you're gonna get shot. It doesn't matter what you do. You black. You can't change that.
Philando Castile said, "Officer, sir, I have a weapon.
Right.
I'm going to
that's
disarm it for you." And he still got shot.
I'm not discrediting any of that stuff. Anything you're saying. I'm just saying everything is to me. Everything's about odds. What can you do to increase the odds or decrease the odds?
This is how you decrease the odds. The way you decrease the odds is that you increase the accountability.
I'm talking about in that moment with that dude and I'm not talking about like long term or overall. I agree with you on all those issues. I'm talking about in that moment, that dude in that backyard with those cops behind him and that helicopter light that helicopter light shining down him. What can you do to decrease the odds that you are going to get shot? That's what I'm talking about.
All right. And he could have decreased them by, you know, like you said, if he complied, maybe that decreases the odds, but it doesn't eliminate them.
No, it doesn't.
I think how people react when they are fearful, when you know that armed people are coming after you and you presume that they want to kill you and you presume that nothing's going to happen if they do. I understand, you know, how he's being. And I'm not, you know, I don't know if that was him doing or whatever. Clearly, you know, you need to be law abiding and you need to try to be a good citizen and stay out of trouble. I agree with all of that. But at the same time, it's just that it can't just be one way. It can't just be, well, black and brown people have to be perfect abiding citizens and maybe we won't shoot you. But
yeah,
Caucasian
maybe.
Individuals, maybe. They can rob, they can shoot, they can bomb.
Ishmael, you remember the time we watched that video? Do you remember we watched that video with the white boy who actually stole the cop car, ran it into something, ran it into the or like chasing the, driving around, chasing the cop, ran into something, fighting the cop. Right. And what happened? How many shots was fired?
Zero.
Shots were fired.
And there was a video of the brawl. There was some, you know, white guys brawling with the cops outside of the club.
Literally
and,
fighting with the cops.
We see that so many times. So
black dude out there, same cops. He on the ground with a knee in the back of his head.
Yeah, I totally agree. But at the end of the day, I want everybody to go home to their family. That's all.
That's the point. That's why we upset.
And people aren't going to go home until these cops start getting locked up. Like, that's the end game. That's the only thing that's going to fix this, because once police start getting arrested and prosecuted and go to jail for the rest of their lives, then that may stop happening. But as long as lawmakers and police officers work to protect these officers instead of getting down to what actually happened, I'm not a person who's like, man, forget all police. I'm like, look, if you do something wrong, if you kill somebody, if you act inappropriately, you should face those consequences. If you don't, hey, I ride with you. We need police. But at the same time, whenever this happens, police just protect each other. There's no accountability. And as long as you can keep shooting folks and get away with it, you know, we had the one guy who got back pay of
$344,000, man.
$344,000 in black.
And the Philando Castile, their family took what I felt was a lowball sum too. I mean, I base these things on case by case basis. I personally think this case is going to be, I agree with you. There should be convictions. I don't think they should do like they did with Michael Brown and some of these other places where they tried to get first degree or second degree murder. I mean, I think they should try to get wins.
You should at least get manslaughter.
You got to charge him with manslaughter to get manslaughter. If you try to give him a first degree case, that's what happened in some of these cases that we're talking about that went down. The DA overcharged him. And then they went to trial based on that charge, and they didn't have enough evidence to match that charge, and they lost. And then it gets kicked out, and you can't do double jeopardy, so you lose.
But it doesn't matter what you do. The dude here in St. Louis that chased the guy down, he said, "I'm gonna kill that MF." Goes and kills him. So it shows that you're clearly is premeditated with your own gun that you brought from home, and you got off.
Yeah, it has nothing to do with overcharging, but the way the laws are set up is to protect the officers in those type of situations. Like, that's why they always say gun, 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 because the laws are written to where if that officer's fearful of his life, then he's exonerated of any issues. Like, the killing is justified. So they can just say gun. Even if there's no gun, they say, well, I thought it was a gun. And by the law in most of these states, that cop is off the hook. So we have to change the laws. We have to hold the officers accountable. Otherwise, it doesn't matter whether we comply, whether we run, whether we do whatever. We're just going to keep getting shot down in the streets.
I agree. But, man, it makes me sick to just know that people get, you know, just don't give. I hear all about that, you know, concern, what's going to happen. You know, they might shoot you anyway. But you should increase the odds. You make the cops chase after you in the middle of the night. It's dark. It's hot. They're sweaty. You're pissing dudes off.
Hey,
they got guns.
If you can't handle the dark, the heat, then you shouldn't be a cop.
Man, my kid.
If you're so scary that every time something happens, you got to shoot somebody, you shouldn't be a cop.
It's not every time that something happens. It's every time
it's a black person.
A black or brown person, because we see that discernment when it's a white kid that, oh no, we can talk now. We can negotiate. We can,
put the gun down, sir,
you don't
want to
do this. You know, we hear and see all of that when it is a white person because they're not threatened. So what we have to do, number one, is get police officers to not be threatened so much by minorities. But number two, when they do something wrong, you got to prosecute them. Like, until that happens, it's just not going to.
But it'll be interesting to see if they're going to prosecute these dudes. I mean, I personally base this on a case by case basis. I think this one's murky as far as whether there's. I think they're going to, based on the rules that are in place right now. I think this one's really tough unless they're going to go with a manslaughter or something lower down the line than first degree or something like that. But now other cases like Philando Castile, I think they should be out there protesting today for that one right there. The Tamar Rice, they should be, you know, Trayvon Martin, they should be protesting out there all day long.
All them people already got off, so it don't matter.
Right.
The protests don't mean nothing if you ain't getting a conviction.
But I'm saying those are the ones that should be. They should be. I think that those cases were stronger personally than at least what I've seen right now in this case right now. I mean, do I think there were mistakes made in this one? Definitely. But I think those were stronger cases. The Philando Castile, they should still be fighting that one, and the family settled, so they got their money, and it wasn't that much, and that's a problem.
Speaking of protests, let's talk about the protests that happened with the Kings game, because we can go around in circles about that forever and ever. But what do you guys think about the protest?
I want to get to the lawyer.
Yeah, we got to talk about that lawyer.
Or that too.
Let's talk about that lawyer, man. With this same dude. He can't speak English, man. And he keeps representing all these people's families. I know he's doing it pro bono. I know we need somebody with experience. But that dude is like 0 for 15. Can we get somebody else, please?
But Ryan, I'm telling you, I personally think that's why that dude's on the case. Because that case is, I think, off top. It's not as strong. And so people didn't want to go after it. And so this dude probably came in there. And you know, he probably called the family the next day.
Is that your conspiracy?
That's my conspiracy. Yeah. And then he could be if you want to talk about a crisis actor, that dude could be a crisis actor. Because he takes the L every time, dog. He takes more L's than the Crying Jordan meme every day.
He needs a picture of him with a Crying Jordan meme.
He is terrible.
He's trash.
He'll be on MSNBC from here for the next 3 months, and he ain't gonna do a damn thing. And
he don't even do a good job of explaining to the TV audience what happened and why somebody shouldn't have been shot.
Yes, he's like murder one and stuff like that. When you could get a somewhat lower charge and get a conviction and get a win, but he takes the L's every time, dude. So to me, the conspiracy is that the case is weak. That's why they hired this dude, because he's not going to win for you. I'm sorry. And email me at hardknockerstl@hotmail.com. hardknockerstl@hotmail.com.
That's my OG account, y'all. You ain't gonna find me on there.
That's his Black Planet. That's his Black Planet account right there.
Well, just for the people, so they're clear, and I'm sure they know who you're talking about. But y'all are talking about attorney Benjamin Crump, he represented Mike Brown's family and his death. He represented a bunch of people who have been slain at the hands of law enforcement. And like you said, he seems like he continues to take L's. Now, for me personally, if I was in that type of a situation, he's not the person that I would run to, mainly for that reason, because I have not seen him win on that stage. But I think part of the reason why he continues to lose is because, like I said before, the laws are just not in the favor of the victims in those things. The laws protect the police officers. So while I'm not all that impressed with what he's done, or at least what I've seen that he's done, I think part of it is just that's how the laws are written. So it's really almost an unbeatable case. Because especially that one you talked about, Ryan, here in St. Louis, where the officer said, I'm going to kill him. The officer got a personal weapon out of a duffel bag in the back seat, ran and killed the guy.
Send me that link, because I've not heard this story before.
We'll send you that one. But it's like, if that one isn't a slam dunk, if you can't get that one through, and that wasn't Crump, I don't believe, representing the family, but that just shows you that the system is broken. So,
and did the DA bring charges or no?
Yeah, they brought charges, but officer exonerated as usual.
Yeah, send me that link. I got to read up on that one. But yeah, the lawyer, I hope he can turn around, but I don't have much faith in that. I mean, me and Ryan, we've been talking about him, that dude, for years, and it just seems like he just can't get it right. He's fighting the good fight, but man, I just don't think he's cut out for it, just personally. But I mean,
Well, I think he does a lot of this stuff pro bono, or maybe not pro bono, but he gets money.
He only gets it off the civil case.
Yeah, he get it off the civil case. I don't think they're paying him. So that's part of the reason is that, you know, this tragedy happens to your family, you don't know where to go, and now you have this lawyer who you've seen him, you know, standing up for families across the country. He tells you, hey, you don't have to pay me. We're going to take care of that in civil suit. I'll just get my little cut. So I think it's easy for them to pick.
I'm going
to
help you take this L.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what it looks like. Cause I'm with you guys. Where it's like, if I'm in that situation, I just can't do it. Like, you read off all your credentials to me. You show me your fancy
all disrespect diplomas. All disrespect. Man, I've heard him on interviews, and it just does not sound. It sounds like me talking, which is totally. I'm a total idiot. So I mean, he's worse than I am talking. It's just bad.
And that was Officer Jason Stokely, who was Stockley. Here.
Flip me that.
Stockley, yeah.
Is it okay?
I put. At least we ended on a happy note. At least we ended on a somewhat lighthearted note at the end there. But that, no, that's a heavy subject.
We're never gonna end on. I'm not happy.
I'm not happy, but somewhat just kind of lighten the mood somewhat, because it is it's a very dark subject, unfortunately.
Yeah, yeah. And unfortunately,
I'm trying to give you a segue there, Ryan. That's all.
Nope, I'm not taking it. Unfortunately, I don't think there's no way we're gonna be able to get around it. I don't know what needs to be done. I don't know what needs to happen. We have done and taught our children everything they're supposed to do with the cops, and it doesn't matter what we do. So at this point, they're going to have to change the laws as far as what's acceptable cop behavior in order to try to stop some of this stuff from happening.
Or but we anyway, can segue into our next topic.
I'm going to segue into Killer Mike.
Well, the answer right there, the Killer Mike leads into get rid of all the guns in the country, potentially including the cops, and then you don't have these problems anymore.
Yeah, right.
Potentially. England and in Europe, they don't have it. In Europe, a lot of the cops don't have guns.
So that's crazy.
So you don't have these situations. I mean, I'm just saying that's one potential answer. It's never going to happen, but that is one potential answer. But anyway, that segues into the gun debate.
Well, that would be actually a great solution, I think, if you take the guns away from the officers, especially, and of course, you know, there would have to be gun control in the general population. But if you take guns away from police officers, then, I think what they do in England is they have like the SWAT team. So if there's an armed situation or there's something that's really dangerous, then they call in, you know, this special task force, which they are armed, but the everyday officers don't have guns, so you can't make those quick, rash judgments. You know, you put officers out there with a taser and a nightstick, and they're going to act way differently when it comes to these type of situations. Exactly. But
they did with Rodney King. They'll just act better. Don't worry about it.
I didn't say they would act better. I said they'll act a wee different.
Yeah, instead you just get a beating like Rodney King. Yeah.
Hey, Rodney King.
Take a beating over a bullet. Yeah.
He's not still alive now. I think he passed later on, but he still lived. You know, that's the same thing when people talk about gun control, and people are like, well, you know, if you take away guns, people just stab you with a knife. Well, I got a much better chance of living through a knife.
Yeah, you got to catch
me
first.
Then I do a gunshot. And plus, if somebody runs into school with a knife, you know, you might get one or two people, but after that, everybody knows what's up. You don't have that same ability to kill a lot of people. So, hey, yeah. I'd definitely rather take a beating than a bullet any day.
Yeah. Hey. So, Killer Mike, he went on an NRA, National Rifle Association, I don't even know what to call this. Is it like a
like
show?
Like a little.
Okay, so he did like an interview, a show kind of thing, with a pro gun advocate on there, and they basically talked about the marches that followed the Parkland shooting, and his views on guns and what they should do about them. Man, I think he played himself, or he let them play him.
I think he got let them play him, yeah.
Yeah, so, Paul, what'd you think? I guess kind of sum up your thoughts on that.
Let me say this. So, I mean,
quickly, since we're over time.
Yeah, so you know, I watched a little bit of the marches and stuff like that. But then, so like late that night, I'm watching, you know, basketball, kind of winding down, you know, catching some highlights on Twitter, and so see Killer Mike's training. I'm like, oh, okay, well, you know, let me click on this, see what happened. And I start seeing all this NRA stuff. I'm like, oh, man. So then they're talking about, like, he's on an NRA video. I'm like, oh, okay, this sounds problematic. And I'm really sitting there debating, like you were, Ryan. I'm like, do I really want to read this, watch this NRA video? Because I know it's just propaganda. But he got on there, and, I mean, he wasn't saying too much. You know, I think his whole point was just that, you know, black people should have guns, which I'm fine with. I have no problem with it. I think it was just more so people had a problem with like the platform he used, which was NRA, and kind of being used by them. And I think more so the NRA using releasing it on the same date as a student march to kind of like, I don't know, like, you know, have a counter narrative going, or I don't know what they thought they were doing. I mean, like, who is Killer? Like, I don't think anybody is Stoneman Douglas. I mean, Killer Mike is like more from people my age, you know, people like, you know, old school rap. I don't think young kids are really listening to him that much. So I don't know what that point was, but they put it out there. And so he made his little points. The one thing that did give him some, his comment that was more problematic was that he was saying for his kids, he told them they better not be in those student marches or else they were going to have to get up out of his house, which I don't know if he was kind of, he sounded like he's somewhat joking, but I think he was being serious about, you know, that we don't believe in that. And so don't be out there protesting. And I think that was kind of the issue I want to bring to you, Ryan and Ish. Like, you know, if you guys had kids, like how like your parenting styles, because I'm a new parent myself, trying to figure this all out. But like, is it are there issues like that hardcore where you're like, hey, you cannot have an opposite opinion before what I think on these things? I think that's more what I wanted to get into with this issue.
Well, that was the most disappointing thing about Killer Mike. And the thing is, even though Killer Mike is an older generation of rapper, he has really become one of the spokespeople when it comes to this movement for social justice and civil rights. You know, he is one of these woke people that has spoken out, you know, against these police shootings and things like that. And he's gained a lot of credibility just because he's spoken out and he's said the right things a lot of times. But now he really kind of destroyed all that credibility that he built up. And like you said, he's saying, if you going to walk out of school, you need to walk out this house. Don't come back, get out my house. Like, that's the most ridiculous thing I ever heard. So how can you sit here and promote for black people to go and protest and stand up and fight for their rights, but when these kids come out and say, hey, we need gun control, we don't want to be afraid, we don't want to be killed in school, then you like, hey, if you do that, get out of my house. Like, that's the most hypocritical and ridiculous thing that I've ever seen. It's fine that you want to be a gun owner. It's nothing wrong with being pro Second Amendment. But at the same time, and the thing about this whole movement, the March for Our Lives and thing that just disgusts me as bad as anything else, you know, like when we talk about the police shooting black people, like, this pisses me off to that same degree that you have people attacking these kids. These are 16, 14, 17-year-old kids that are saying, hey, we don't want to be killed, and people are mocking them and making fun of them and saying, F them kids. It's like, really? Like, right. That's what we have become as a society, to where we'd say children need to shut up for saying, I'm unsafe. Protect me. Like, that's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard.
When you go against the majority, whoever they are, in this situation is gun owners, and that in our situation is blacks against whites, all of a sudden the headlines become shut up, and you don't have a voice, or you don't know what you're talking about. When you know, I'm upset, well, not really upset, but I'm, I guess, saddened that Killer Mike would allow himself then to be used as a pawn by the NRA. He's smarter than that. He knows that they're gonna at least try to spin his interview. He tried to say that, you know, oh, I'm trying to do the Martin Luther King thing, and I'm trying, in his apology, I'm trying to do the Martin Luther King thing and sit with people across the aisle from me. Yeah, they wasn't across the aisle from you, because in that situation, you was in the aisle.
Yeah,
and we should clarify, sitting in the seats with him.
And we should clarify, he did apologize this morning, I believe it was. You know, kind of said like, "Hey, you know,
too late."
Yeah, too late.
You can apologize. You can apologize when you want to, but when you were talking, you said the truth of what you felt, and I'm fine with that. Now, if you totally changed your mind on what you said, that's something different. But I don't think in this regard, he doesn't change his mind what he said. He's pro gun, and that's what he wants to be. He doesn't want his kids protesting guns, and that's his stance on it, and that's fine. But you deal with the repercussions of what you said.
Yeah, because so, as we all know, like, when you generally parents that push their kids to be so militant on one area, that usually the kids, it backfires and the kids go the opposite way. We see that with religion, you know, other, you know, gay rights, all types of things like that. So I think, it sometimes it works out, but sometimes it doesn't. So you got to be really careful. I'm still working. I haven't perfected my parenting style, obviously, but I think that's what I'm going to try to go with, you know, like, hey, don't get too riled about these particular issues. And try to say, ultimately, hey, you can't think this other way. And that's just kids are going to rebel, man. It's a natural instinct at some point, teenagers to rebel against their parents on these things like that. So,
yeah. And to answer your question, Paul, so parenting wise, now he even said this in the interview, although everybody's harping on the fact that he said to get out of his house. But he also was stating that he doesn't want his kids to go with maybe the national narrative every time something happens. He wants them to be able to think and make a decision on what they choose to protest or not protest.
But not now, he's assuming,
yeah, he's assuming that his kids don't know what's going on or don't know, you know, what they're protesting. Maybe they do. I'm sure they do. They're not stupid. You know, if your dad is killing Mike and he going out saying the things that he's been saying all these last few years about social justice and all that kind of stuff, I'm sure your kids are woke enough where they can make their own decisions and make up their own minds on things. And I lean towards that, too. I don't want to force my ideologies on my children, but at the same time, I want them to understand where my ideology comes from. Ultimately, they're grown. When they're grown, they're going to make their own decisions, but I'm going to tell them how, you know, what daddy thinks this way and this is why. And what do you think? And I don't mind having that conversation.
Word.
Yeah, and you have to be smart enough to understand that, again, it's okay to be pro Second Amendment and to not want to completely outlaw guns. Like, that's a conversation that we can have. But the NRA, you know, as a person who has stood up and, you know, stood up for black people and has gotten a certain stature, you know, for black Americans, for you to go and like be with the NRA and be defending the NRA, like, that's just crazy. Like, you can defend the gun part, but to defend the NRA, who has just been vile and cruel and just, you know, ridiculous when it comes to African Americans, when it comes with this, all of these gun laws and things like that. Like, that's just the most ridiculous part.
Oh, before we forget, Ish, my man said on that interview that guns could solve the country's problems.
Right.
He said right out of his mouth, more guns can solve the country's problems. Yeah, it was an infomercial.
It's the counter-argument to what Ish and I were just talking about with take all the guns away from the cops, and then that'll solve the issue. It's the counter-argument, give everyone a gun, and then you solve all the other issues the other way.
Yeah, then it'll be fine.
And it's a stupid argument because...
the dumbest thing.
This is what people forget, because I saw that, somebody on my Facebook feed posted something like, you know, which one is safer for your children? And they had a sign that said no guns, you know, allowed, gun free zone. They had another sign that said staff is armed, you know, bring in a gun at your own risk, or something to that sentiment. And it's like, neither of them is going to save a child. You know, it's kind of like the same thing we talked about with the cop. Whether you act right or whether you don't act right, you can get shot. The same thing with these guns, because when you look at, what is it, Fort Hood military base, where I forget how many people, but a bunch of people got killed at a military base. Yeah. Everybody is armed at a military base.
That's when not
you
look true. At the, that's,
and if well, the, if the, everybody, would, and if the black kids army. Are, if the black kids are being mistreated at a school where the teachers don't have guns, what you think gonna happen when the teachers have guns? Who gonna get shot?
Right. You just saw that teacher who got fired for beating up the kid, beating him over the head.
Beating
that
dude over the head.
If that teacher had a
yes.
gun, what would have happened? Or you look at that club in Orlando that got shot up. They had an armed security guard. When you look at Stoneman Douglas High School, they had an armed secure or armed police officer that was there who didn't do nothing. So even when we have armed people in these situations, if a mass shooter decides, I'm gonna go shoot up this place, is nothing that's really going to stop them. So you can't just look at, let's give everybody guns, because that's still not going to solve the problem.
Unless the shooter's black. If the shooter's black, he won't get a chance to play again.
Right.
If he even got a cell phone, he's going to get shot on the premise.
I'm not laughing, but I'm laughing. Because
you know it's true.
That's not the sad part.
I'm laughing. Right. Yeah. Got to find some humor, some levity in all this stuff, man. Anyway.
Yeah, man. So what's next? I think I'm... sufficiently depressed from all of these topics.
let's cheer ourselves up. Let's talk about some. That's the depressing stuff. Let's get to the happier news now.
Yeah. All right. So we're gonna even skip El Trumpo.
No. That's the part I want to talk.
You want to talk about that? No. These other two are more funny than that.
I don't even see the only. I see Biden, Trump, and Amber Rose. The only two I see.
And then we got your Tekashi 69.
Oh, but that's just like 5 seconds. That don't mean matter about that.
All right. Well, all right. Let's talk about Trump then. Yeah. Fine.
It says
trade wars. It should not. Oh, matter of fact, I think I pressed the wrong one. But no, it should say Trump versus Biden.
Yeah.
Your president, Paul. Your president out here in these streets now. Now this dude is threatening to beat up people, man. He talking about how if he got into a fight with Joe Biden, that Joe Biden would go down hard and he would be crying the whole time.
That's right. And this all started because Biden in a speech he's talking about, you know, like bullying and stuff like that, and he's like, you know, he basically said he would knock a guy out like that. Like, he didn't say directly about Trump, but a guy like Trump, he would knock that guy out if he was younger. Blah, blah.
So in this situation, is Biden the bully or is Trump the bully?
It's debatable. I don't want to really get into who's right, who's wrong. I want to know who'd win. That's what I want to know. So and I'm gonna throw it to Ish. Ish is our resident boxing expert. So Ish, I'm gonna throw it to you, man. I mean, I want to know. I want to break it down. I mean, Trump 71, Biden 75, I believe. Trump is they're both about the same height. They're both about 6'3". Trump's definitely much heavier than Biden. I mean, so we got to, you know, this is the no weight division on this one. But I mean, who you got in this one, Ish? Well, I mean, break it down for me. I need to know.
Well, I'll break this down very briefly. I don't want to go too deeply into this. But here you go. So these are the strengths and weaknesses of these two gentlemen. I think when you look at Trump, it is hard for me to believe that he could beat up anybody. Like, I just can't picture him throwing hands at all. Like, I can't see it. He's just not coordinated. He's not, like, he's just one of those guys that talk a big game. He run his mouth. But then if he gets hit, he's going to cry and run away after the first blow. So with that said, I think that Biden would be the clear favorite, even though Biden may be a little bit older. He's more in shape. You know, he seems like he's probably been in a couple fights. I don't think Trump has ever been in a real fist fight. I think that Biden has, you know, it might have been a little preppy boy, whatever. The thing I think Trump has on his side is that Trump is really just kind of pure evil. You know, he doesn't have any type of, I don't know. He's just evil. And so he doesn't have any limits. So this is what I think happens in the fight. I think that, you know, they square off or whatever. Trump is popping off at the mouth. I think Biden hits him with a couple jabs, hit him with a couple straight hands. Trump is trying to get out of there. And then I think he bites Joe Biden's ear off. He just goes full Mike Tyson.
He definitely cheat.
He bites him. He pokes him in the eye. He, you know, grabs at his manhood, something to where Trump is going to get disqualified. And then he's going to claim that the disqualification was rigged and it was collusion. And he's going to say that he really won because Biden quit, even though he poked out Biden's eye or bit off his ear or something like that.
Who you got, Ryan?
Yeah. I'm going to go with Joe Biden. We all know what happened. What Donald Trump did when that dude ran up on him at the one of his rallies back when he was running for president. He slid off the stage so fast.
God, did you,
and so quickly.
Yes. Did you see the GIF?
Most athletic thing Donald Trump has ever
done. Right. Been.
Did you ever see the GIF when he's got the bald eagle in his office and the eagle flaps his wings?
Right.
Did you see that?
No.
Google that, Rob.
Oh, yeah.
That.
Okay. He's so scary. This is the same man that talks about, yeah, I would have ran into the school with the shooting and I would have faced off with the... Man, please. You scared
we ain't never
of
heard
Google.
You doing nothing courageous.
Just
you
quickly,
got
just,
out of war because you had bone spurs like four different times. Come on.
Just quickly, I'm gonna take the contrarian view on this. I'm gonna take Trump. I'm only gonna say this because I think he's got like the bald bull charge in him. You know, like from Mike Tyson's punch out. Like, I don't think he'll last long. If it goes more than a round, I think he's done. But I think maybe in that first like 40 seconds, like he can just get himself into such a rage. Like if he watches like the Stormy Daniels interview right before he goes out there to fight, like I think he could like, you know, just put together a good 30, 40 seconds of just haymakers and maybe just like a straight up charge mixed martial arts thing. And I think he might be able to take him just because he's got 70 pounds on by. That's all I'm saying.
This is how the fight would look. Do you guys remember the viral video? And hopefully I can find it for the show notes. Where it was like three old guys fighting outside of a senior's home. And it was like every time one would take a swing, they would fall down. And then one guy would kick the other guy on the ground. And then he kicked and he fell down. It was like these three old people fighting and they just kept falling every time they tried to take a swing. That's what this fight would look like. It would just be Biden and Trump just falling because both of them are old. Both of them are not athletic, and neither one of them can probably hit. So it'd just be broken hips and everything.
Hey, all I'm saying is you add this on to the undercard for Canelo Alvarez, I'm paying for it. I ain't trying to bootleg it. I ain't trying to stream it off off Twitter, anything cheap. I'm paying for this. I'm paying pay-per-view for this if it happens.
Y'all can keep it.
Exactly.
I ain't paying not a dollar to see that because that fight going to be over real quick because everybody going to be tired.
I'm still going to watch it.
But anyway, speaking of tired, Amber Rose is not tired of smelling 21 Savage's dirty drawers.
Yeah.
She admitted in an article on the Daily Mail, she confirmed that her and 21 broke up. And that she still loves him and she misses him so much that every day she smells his old underwear.
I'm gonna let Ish take this one first.
Yeah.
I don't even have any comment for that foolishness. I got nothing, bro.
Meanwhile,
this is my first time hearing this story.
And oh, is it really?
The last time I will.
No, hold on. If that's all you've heard, hold on. Give me a sec. Let me read a little bit of it.
Yeah, go down further. Go down further.
Yeah. Okay. This should be a hashtag right here. If you don't love the smell of your man's private area, then you don't really love him. That should be the hashtag.
So the question is... Every day. We can't... I'm not even going to get into it. But this is my whole thing, man. This lady... Man, she's just trying. I mean, hey, God bless her. She's trying her hardest to make herself stay relevant. I mean, like she was with Kanye, then she just kind of kept moving down the charts of hot rappers, and now she's with. I mean, she's with dudes. Yeah, she got kids. She's with single dudes, 15, 20 years younger than her. I mean, come on, girl, just chill.
She's 34. He's 25.
She's allegedly 34. She's probably. That means she's probably really 38. But anyway, you know, man, just. Hey, you get a lot of likes on Instagram. It's you don't have to, you know, you don't have to show off your butt all the time. Just chill out. I mean, be a mom. Be normal. You ain't got to be sitting there smelling some rapper's drawer, some 25-year-old rapper's drawers. I guarantee those drawers do not smell good. There's no way.
Yeah, Amber Rose is just grimy. She's just a grimy individual. You know what I'm saying? It's like. You know, Kevin Gates to be talking about eating booty in every other song. You know, Amber Rose is like the white female Kevin Gates, you know, only not as real because I do actually like Kevin Gates. So I don't know. She's just grimy. I don't.
Oh, was that a subtweet at her fake butt or is that? That might have been. I think so.
Not at all. I'm just, you know.
Is it real?
She can do her own thing, bruh. But that's just, I don't even pay attention to Amber Rose.
Yeah.
I just don't.
Yeah, do not.
I think
what's the good minister have to say?
All right, here we go. So I'm gonna spin it. Spin it.
All right.
So I gotta say before I say this, 21. I just like when he said it on songs. It's kind of lame, but it's kind of cool at the same time. So I'm gonna say that maybe there's a possibility that Amber is just good old Amber from the block that she tries to say she is. Like when she was on Drink Champs, she was just a normal girl. Just things worked out for her, and she's amassed this multi-million-dollar empire. And now she's just looking for love. And she says she loves him, she misses him, she thinks about him every day. And she said, you know, hopefully they can work it out. But to her, she's still with him, and she's not single because she still loves him. And this will keep her in the good graces of the world. And she'll move on to the next rich dude that comes along. I mean, I'm not really an Amber fan. Not that she's done anything wrong, but...
What's wrong, and look at this picture. Look, if you look at the article, look at this picture of her with Kanye. Look how slim she looks compared to the picture above, man. She's had so much work done to her. Why do you... You look fine back then. Just leave your body alone, man. You just... Why do you want this big, huge butt? Okay, I guess it gets you more Instagram likes, but just... It can't... It's not going to be... It's not going to look good in 20 years, that's for sure.
Yeah. I think... I mean, I think she's a lot smarter than she tries to portray. Because on that... You listen to that Drink Champs, didn't you, Paul?
Man, I like Nori, but I tried
to... I didn't listen to the whole thing. Yeah, yeah. It's hard sometimes. But that was a good episode, but it was so long. But, you know, she was pretty much just trying to... say that she was just normal and, you know, things just happen and people think that she's manipulative, but she's not, and this kind of stuff. But I think she's just smart enough to know, you know, that she's going to play that innocent card, and it keeps her brand going. It keeps her in everybody's good graces, and she could just stick and move as she need to stick and move until she get where she want to be at. I mean, you got the richest rapper in the world. You got a baby by him. You cool. And 21 was kind of coming up, so maybe you hop on that one, and you know, if that don't work out, we hop on somebody else. Because she did say she would only talk to somebody that was rich or famous, some kind of way. But then she kind of said that no, I would talk to anybody. Like, no, you wouldn't.
Look, she's famous, she's nasty, and she got money. So for those reasons, she's always gonna be, you know, in the media. She always gonna be able to get a man. So it is what it is.
Man, all I know is a girl told me she would sniff my drawers if I ever left her. Like, that's automatic grounds for divorce right there. That's a no-go in my book.
Yeah, that's crazy right there.
That must be this new Paul, because the Paul that I know from some years ago would have been all about that life. That's what I'm gonna say.
Hey, I've matured.
I think he used the lead with that. Like, girl, would you sniff my drawers if I left you? I'm gonna ask the
going
wife.
Going in
man.
The club, like, hey, can I sniff your drawers, girl?
Oh, no, that's fair game now.
Now, Paul, I'm gonna let you do this last topic, man.
Oh man, so, I don't have no topic here, but like, yeah, I've been reading about this Tekashi 6ix9ine dude. So he's like half Mexican, half Puerto Rican. He's from New York.
So your people. Your people.
My people, yes. And so he's had a lot of issues here lately. I guess, you know, I don't know too much about the music. I've heard a couple songs. I hear what Deezus and Mero, they have a good little imitation they do of his song, which is pretty funny whenever he's talked about on their podcast. But he's been in a lot of beef out there on the streets. I guess he went to some concert in Los Angeles, and, you know, I guess he's a blood affiliate. And so I guess he didn't want to check in with other blood affiliates there. And so I guess that caused some problems. And supposedly there was some kind of like altercation at LAX, which some people say was staged. And then kind of whenever he's gone around to other shows, I guess people have been coming, trying to come get him or talk to him or try to fight him and things like that. So it's really messy. And there was like a big thing the other day where I guess the rapper The Game, like posted a long Instagram message basically saying like, hey, watch your back because I'm coming to get you, or we're going to come get you because you're not really representing this life and stuff like that. So this dude, I'm ready now to go ahead and make a trade. So we are really the trade. The Brown delegation is willing to trade Tekashi 6ix9ine for pretty much anybody, but we will trade him for Soulja Boy Tellem. So I just want to propose that, throw that out there, and just see what the Black delegates want to do on this trade proposal. Will you accept?
Denied.
All right. If he hadn't accepted it, I was about to David Stern that mug and come
that's
through.
Like,
and
that's like trying to trade Michael Jordan for Paul. Like,
I'm not even asking for a little bow. I'm asking for a Soulja Boy Tellem. You're not going to give me Soulja Boy. Who will you give me?
Who will I give you? I mean, this dude is pretty embarrassing, man. Yeah, we don't really want him. I might give you O.J. Simpson, maybe.
Right.
Or possibly Bill Cosby.
Or Benjamin Crump.
Yeah, we'll give you a 3-for-1. Bill Cosby, O.J. Simpson. No, I can't even give you Crump.
No, you have to take all our bad contracts. That's what you got to
right,
do.
Right.
And a future high pick from the Hispanic delegation.
Okay. Yeah.
There we go.
Don't worry. We got a Miss Universe. We'll toss to you guys in a few years. Don't worry.
Think,
we got one on deck.
Think about that.
I told you I wanted Vicente Fox, so he's going to have to be included in that.
You got it.
Let's see. Who are some other Hispanics that we need in our delegation? Yeah, we'll have to figure that out. But you're gonna have to pay heavy if you want to unload that him off. You're gonna have to pay deep.
Well, we have to get the old retired contracts of Big Pun, people like that. We want
right.
It don't
right.
matter. They ain't got to be alive. We want their contracts. Just send them right.
Okay. Well, I tried my best to get Soulja Boy tell him on our side, but it didn't work out. So that's really it. Just want to wrap it up with a little lighthearted note for this heavy podcast. But I think this was a really good one, Ryan. I'll go to you guys to close it out.
Yeah, we'll see. I guess, where can they find us at, Phenol?
You can find us on Twitter. We are at Black Delegates. There's an underscore between Black and Delegates. You can follow the Black Ryan at the Black Ryan on Twitter. You can follow me at Ghetto Phenom. We are also on the Facebook, although everybody is getting off the Facebook, so maybe that's a conversation that we have to have. But on Facebook, we are Black Delegates Pod. And Ryan, where can people find the podcast?
Get the podcast on Podbean, iTunes, I think we're on Stitcher. Anywhere where there's an RSS feed, you can probably find us at this point, I believe.
Yeah, man. And make sure that you hit that subscribe button. If you have not rated the podcast, go ahead and rate us. And yeah, just check us out, man. We're going to be out here every week doing our thing. Shout out to G. G could not make it today. But we definitely want to give him a shout out.
Yeah, he couldn't make it because he was at the movies.
At the movies. Wah-wah. Probably seeing Black Panther a second time. He's probably seeing the first half of Black Panther this time.
Then snuck into another movie to see the second half of that one.
Right.
We'll hear about that later.
Absolutely.
All right, so that's it for this week. Tell a friend to tell a friend.
Yep, for sure. And hey, real quick, I do want to shout out two other podcasts real quick that are friends of the show. First of all, Keepers of the Funk. Check those guys out if you're into hip-hop and things like that.
What up, Ghost?
Had to have a homie Ghost on the show pretty soon. Also, In the Zone Podcast Network, good homie of mine that does a lot of sports, and they do some different things besides sports, too. So check out In the Zone. That is just the letter N, the zone, and Keepers of the Funk. We just trying to, you know, give some shout outs to other Black podcasters that are doing their things out there.
They're in the zone, fix that feed. Did they fix that feed? Can I try that again? All right. I'm gonna try it.
Fix your feed, fellas.
All right. So if there is nothing else, we'll see y'all next week.
Later.
Peace.